my Bible. I am what it says I am. We're here to lift you and not put you down.
Awesome to have you with us, joining us online and live on SiriusXM. We love you guys. You are favored. You are royal. You have God's blood flowing through your veins. You are a child of the Most High God. Thanks for tuning in today. We've got a great service lined up for you. Friend of mine, Dr. Rick Rigsby, is going to be sharing with you today. What a powerful minister. You're going to be blessed. I'll promise you this. You're going to, when you turn this off, you're going to be better than you were before. So get ready for God to do something new in your life. I believe even right now, as we're worshiping Him, as we're praising Him, you know what's happening? God's breathing fresh vision back into your spirit. Strength, joy, victory, clarity of thought. We just speak God's very best over you today. And anything that's trying to hold you down, I believe those powers are being broken right now. Thanks for being with us. Hey, don't just be a spectator, be a participator with us in your own way. Come on, let's worship Him together. Maybe we're not here in person, but we are joined together in spirit. We're linked arms. We're going to have a great service. You're going to have a blessed week. We just speak overflow over you and your family. Thanks again for tuning in.
Yes, it is so good to be with you today. And we know that God is in the blessing business, and He sees you right where you are. The scripture says that He is a rewarder of those who seek after Him. You know, seeking means you're going for Him. You are looking for Him. You are expecting Him to move in your life. So know that God sees you when you seek Him. Now, I know in my own life, I've been asking God for something or seeking Him for an answer to a question or maybe for a situation to turn around, and I can get tired. I can think, when, God, when? And you know, when we have thoughts, where we get weary and we get tired. The thought of giving up or letting go can come into our thoughts. Doubt can creep in, and we wonder if God's even going to move. The scripture says in Galatians 6, don't get weary in well-doing. Don't get weary in seeking God for your answer. Don't get weary in well-doing, because it says in due time, due season, you will reap if you faint not. Can I tell you that there is a due season for you right up ahead, but you can't give up. See, Paul was urging us to stick with it, stay with it. What he was saying was, you know, there'll be days you don't feel like seeking. There'll be days you don't feel like asking. You don't feel like looking. But he is saying, keep your eyes on the promise, because that due season is right up in front of you. See, God didn't say you won't get tired. He didn't say that you won't make a mistake. He didn't say that you wouldn't feel like doing it. He was urging us through the Apostle Paul to just don't give up. I believe today that if you felt those thoughts of doubt, if you felt like, God, are you gonna do it? I believe right now, as you look to God during this program, He is going to fill you with strength. He is going to fill you with determination. You are gonna feel a release in your spirit to move forward in strength, knowing that God will never fail you and your due season is right up in front of you. Let's pray together that God is releasing His blessing in your life right now. Father, I thank you as I join my faith with my brothers and sisters. Lord, that your strength is being released, that a newness, a refreshing is being imparted into my brothers and sisters. Lord, we believe it by faith, because that's what this walk is all about. It's a walk of faith. So Father, we know that you move when we have faith. So right now, we thank you in advance, Father, that due season is coming, and it's coming quickly. Father, we thank you we won't give up, but we sense your presence in us right now, and we thank you for it in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen.
Sing the praises of the Spirit. 'cause grace rewrote my story. I'll testify by Jesus Christ the righteous. I'll testify. This is my testimony. Oh,
you've opened my eyes of faith, and now I see. chains are gone. I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy rained. Unending love, amazing grace. Unending love, amazing grace. Unending love, amazing.
thank you that you are a way maker, that you are the miracle worker, that you're a promise keeper. Lord, we've seen your goodness in our lives again and again. Lord, we don't take for granted that every good thing comes from you, our Father in heaven above. And Lord, we're not here today with a sad song. We're here with a song of praise. We recognize your greatness in our lives. But Lord, we wouldn't be standing here today. You gave us breath to breathe. You gave us strength to get out of bed. Lord, we can all look back in our lives and see times where you made a way where we didn't see a way. Lord, we're here to say thank you for all that you've done. We recognize your goodness in our lives. And Lord, as we start off this new week, we just say it publicly. You're our Lord, our God, our Savior. Make us and mold us into who you want us to be. Lord, I thank you that you're opening the right doors, closing the wrong doors, that you're bringing the right people across our path, and Lord, weed out those that shouldn't be there. Help us to make decisions that honor you. I thank you, Lord, that we have the mind of Christ, that we are full of wisdom. Lord, I thank you that you've already anointed us, equipped us, and empowered us, that we are well able to do what you've called us to do. Lord, I thank you right now, as we're worshiping you, that every force that's trying to stop us is being broken in the name of Jesus. Lord, I thank you today is a breakthrough day. Chains of depression, fear, discouragement, addictions, sicknesses, relationship issues. Lord, I thank you things are beginning to turn even right now. We may not see it yet, but Lord, we believe you're working. We believe forces of darkness are broken. So Lord, we put our shoulders back. We hold our head up high. We know you being for us is more than the world being against us. You being for us is more than a pandemic trying to stop us. It's more than a hurricane. It's more than any kind of damage. Lord, we thank you that you're still in control, that you are on the throne, that even now you're pushing back forces of darkness for us. Lord, we thank you for it. You've done it in the past. We know you'll do it again in the future. And Lord, I do lift up those that are fighting battles in their health. Lord, you said you sent your word and healed them. So I thank you, Lord, healing is flowing into your people all over the world, in the hospitals, those that are in pain, those that couldn't make it. Lord, I thank you right now, healing, wholeness, strength, victory. Lord, I thank you that they will run and not be weary. They will walk and not faint, that the number of our days you will fulfill. Lord, I thank you that you're doing a new thing in people's lives and in their physical health right now. And Lord, not just physically, but I lift up those that have gone through loss, heartache, those that are in tough times. You said you are close to the brokenhearted. Let them feel your presence even right now. Comfort them, Lord, with your loving kindness, with your tender mercies. Lord, let them know this is not the end, but it's only a new beginning. That even though it was meant for their harm, that you know how to turn it and still bring good out of it. Lord, that you've armed them with strength for this battle. So Lord, I speak strength into every person. I speak new beginnings, fresh vision into your spirit. Lord, I think your weeping may endure for a night, but joy is coming in the morning. I speak that joy in Jesus' name. Lord, we thank you 2020 won't be an average year, not just a defeated year, not just a year of a pandemic, but Lord, it'll be an overflow year, that we are victors, never victims, in Jesus' name. And if you believe it, can you say amen today? I know you do. Well, so awesome having you with us online, again, listening live on Sirius XM. You know, we love you. We pray for you. I love what we were just singing because it's so true. Just because you don't see anything happening doesn't mean that God is not working. I've learned most of the time God is working the most when you see it and feel it the least. In other words, that's what faith is all about. Joel, I'm praying, I'm believing, but I don't see anything changing. Don't be discouraged and think that God is not working. In the unseen realm, things are changing in your favor. God is getting you prepared. He's getting things lined up. He's arranging the right people. Come on, you got to stay in faith, knowing that you're going to walk into some blessings. You're going to walk into some favor. You're going to walk into some things that God has already prepared for you. Now, maybe right now he's getting you prepared for what he's already prepared. So you keep believing. You keep standing strong in faith. I say it every service, the forces that are for you are greater than the forces that are against you. Come on, make a declaration of faith with me. You may not feel it, but say it by faith. Ready? I am blessed, prosperous, redeemed, forgiven, talented, creative, confident, secure, disciplined, focused, prepared, qualified, motivated, valuable, free, determined, equipped, empowered, anointed, accepted, and approved. Not average, not mediocre. I am a child of the Most High God. I will become all I was created to be. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. God bless you today. Hey, I have something real special for you today. I want you to meet a great friend of mine, somebody you probably already know. It's Dr. Rick Rigsby. He doesn't want me to call him doctor, but Dr. Pastor Rick, come on up. So awesome to have you. Just imagine everybody clapping for you right now. We're not supposed to shake, but all right. We're good. All right. Love having you here, Pastor.
Thank you, Pastor.
So Pastor Rick Rigsby has been part of Lakewood before. Pastor, you were here at our men's conference way back, a few years back, and got to meet you there. But, you know, Pastor Rick's an amazing communicator, amazing pastor. You know, what caught my attention the other day is you gave a graduation speech that now has 300 million views on YouTube. I mean, God's just opened up incredible doors. We were talking before the service today about just, you know, what God's doing in your life. But let's, we got a time. Pastor Rick's going to be sharing a message with you in a few minutes, but I wanted to just maybe visit for a few here first. But Pastor, you know, what brings you to Texas? What are you doing here?
First of all, Pastor Joel, thank you so much for the gracious invitation to be with the Lakewood family. I never thought I'd live in Texas. I grew up in Northern California, but my father was a Texan, and he was the only one in his family that lived in the greater Houston and Huntsville area to migrate after World War II to California. And back in the early 90s, I got a job offer that I couldn't refuse from a school called Texas A&M University.
Giggle. That's a good one.
And I am now a Texan and absolutely love it.
I love that. And you taught at Texas A&M professor there for many, many years. What'd you teach? And tell me about a little bit of that.
Absolutely. I was a professor in the Department of Communications, and I taught classes that looked at the way in which the media attempts to construct reality in society, which is fascinating. I also taught classes that dealt with film appreciation, persuasion, interpersonal communication, but the class that I love the most was a class on social movements. It was titled The Rhetoric of the Civil Rights Movement. And we focused on what we traditionally call the Black Church. And I made the argument that if it wasn't for women and if it wasn't for the Black Church, there would have been no civil rights movement.
Wow.
Yeah.
What is your take now in this, you know, there's some social unrest. What's your take on all this now? How can we do better? Any thoughts there?
Yes, sir. I think, you know, that the whole goal, in my opinion, is to model Christ. And I have been asking myself, what do you want me to do? My father, that was featured in that video, the wisest man I've ever met in my life, a third grade dropout. He's been gone for 25 years, but I still talk to him. And I said, Dad, talk to your son during this time of tremendous racial strife, talk to me. And I could hear my father through the Holy Spirit saying, Son, before you can expect to see change out there, you need to see change in here. Pastor Joel, you know what I've been doing ever since the George Floyd murder? I've been getting on my knees saying, oh, wretched man that I am, who will deliver me from this body of death? I remember that great preacher, R.A. Torrey, once. He was preaching a revival and stopped. He said, go home, get on your knees, put a circle around yourself, and start the revival with the person in the circle. What a great opportunity for us to stand up and be Christ right now. You know, the church is on the front porch of America. It's on the front porch of the world. People are listening like never before to what we have to say. They're watching our every move. Why not use this as an opportunity to point people to the hope found at the revelation of Jesus Christ?
I love that. Pastor Rick, you mentioned your father. Of course, we have similar stories in that our father had a great impact on us. Never dreamed I would be here, but You know, you spoke of your father, that, you know, a third grade dropout, but give us some of those lessons, or talk about your dad, because that's so moving.
Yes, sir. So my father grew up in this area, grew up in Houston and Huntsville. After World War II, waves goodbye to all his family members, says, I'm moving to a foreign country, San Francisco. The only job he could really find was as a cook. And he got this job as a cook at a place called California Maritime Academy. In order for these men and women to graduate from this school, they have to serve on a training ship. They have to sail 3 months out of every single year. My father's a cook. He's on the support staff, so he has to go right along with these cadets. In the process, he falls in love with a country woman from Oklahoma, my mom. They start their family, my mother and my father, God-fearing people who taught us the Word of God. All of a sudden, my daddy from Texas, probably never even been in a rowboat, is now sailing all over the world. I have 4 degrees. My brother is a presidential appointed judge. We're not the smartest ones in our family. A third grade dropout daddy who sailed the world with simple principles. Principles like, son, yes, daddy, don't judge people. Right out the Bible, don't judge. He would say to me, son, I've been all over the world. I've seen good and bad in every shade. The tendency of a human being is to judge based on what you see. You know what he was saying, Pastor? If all you see is what you see, you don't see all there is that needs to be seen. Mm-hmm. He would say, son, you'd rather be an hour early than a minute late. Come on now. You can have as many fish as you want on the back of your car, but if you show up 25 minutes late on a daily basis, it's just not going to cut it. My father had the breakfast shift. He had to be at the California Maritime Academy at 5 a.m. For 30 years, my mother said he left an hour early. She asked him once why. Listen to his response. One of these days, one of my boys will be up and catch me in the act of excellence. Wow. Aristotle said, you are what you repeatedly do. Therefore, excellence ought to be a habit, not an act. Our Holy Bible says, whatever we do, do with excellence. Yeah. My father would share with me, son, be kind to people. Son, be a servant. Make sure your servant's towel is bigger than your ego. Ego is the anesthesia that deadens the pain of stupidity. Just calm it down. It's very difficult, son, to serve somebody when you're full of yourself. My father's greatest lesson, one of his greatest lessons was, if you do anything, you do your best. He would say it in his vernacular. He would say, son, if you're going to do a job, do it right. I know it ought to be do it well, but I love the way that my father would say that. Simple lessons from a simple man who, in my opinion, lived an epic life in his quiet kind of way. I find it so ironic that my father was a quiet tower of strength, but yet he's being quoted on every continent now in the world.
That is so awesome. He, you know, his lessons took root in your life because you told me as well at A&M, I'm going to jump back there while you were there, the coach had you teach character. And talk about some of that.
It's an amazing story. I'm a professor in 1992 in the Department of Communication. I have a chance meeting with now one of my dearest friends, R.C. Slocum, legendary football coach. Yeah. And we started talking and he says, you know, I have position coaches for my football team, but I want a life skills coach. I want somebody that will coach these young men up in the areas of character, in the areas of life. And he made an interesting statement to me, Pastor. Coach Slocum, back then, was prophetic, said, my reputation won't be contingent based on wins and losses. My reputation will be based on how my men turned out. And so what we were realizing, what Coach realized for years, is that you would challenge these young men to be men. Many of them had never seen a man before in the home. How can you be something you've never seen? And so he created a position, life skills coordinator, a character coach, if you will. And together with the other coaches, we had the privilege of infusing, are you ready for this? Lessons from a third grade dropout. We never thought it'd be a book. We never thought it'd be a speech. We were just trying to encourage young men with common sense wisdom that would strengthen their walk, strengthen their character, encourage them for a lifetime.
That's so powerful. And Pastor Rick, so you go around the world now, but let's go back. So you were a professor for a while, but the call to ministry came later in your life, or maybe you can talk about that.
I was actually called to preach the gospel back in the 80s in the middle of a PhD program. God has a sense of humor. And we argued for a few years, but there was a call on my life. But you're absolutely right. It would come later when our dear friend and our spiritual father, Bishop Joseph Garlington, sensed it and said, it's time. And I was feeling very comfortable. You know what's interesting, Pastor Joel and friends out there? You can be so comfortable in life, so comfortable at your station, you miss God's best for you. Mm. And I almost allowed that to happen because here I am. I'm on the faculty at A&M. I'm privileged to be a member of the football coaching staff. I don't want to move. I don't want to leave. But God's call on my life. I get to Dallas. I meet some wonderful people, Pastors Michael and Debbie Gamble, come alongside and buy into the vision that God has given them to plant a church in a suburb of Dallas called McKinney, Texas. The church is called Radiant Life Church, and privileged to be an associate pastor at that church until God moved me on. That was a church plant of 8 years ago. But the call on my life has been profound. I mean, my mother would say that she would pass by the bathroom back in the 60s and she would hear me preaching. I think G.I. Joe got saved every Saturday night. I think bars of soap got filled with the Spirit.
I love that. Pastors Michael and Debbie are with us today. I'm glad they flew down. Thanks, guys, for being here. But
yeah,
I love that. And I wanted to touch on, so really, when that you gave that college graduation speech, you didn't know what was going to happen there.
I got to tell you something funny, Pastor Joel. I was in Oklahoma speaking to a group of pastors. It was October 5th, 2017. Now, prior to that, we averaged about 40, 50 engagements. It was comfortable. We loved it. We were heavily involved in our role as pastors at Radiant Life Church. Our life was just incredible. So I get a call after ministering to these pastors in Tulsa, Oklahoma. My wife, Janet, not given to exaggeration, complete opposite of me, logical, linear, doesn't get all flustered. She calls screaming, Rick, you have a video that has 500,000 views. By the time we get off the phone, it's 1 million. By the time we go to bed that night, it's 9 million. By the time I wake up the next morning, it's 15 million. By the time I fly back to Dallas from Tulsa, 25 million. And just like that, a speech that I had given all over the world just went virtual today, over 300 million views. But you know what's the most amazing part of that, Pastor Joel? The letters and the cards that we get from people who have said, I put the gun down. I tore up the suicide note. I didn't have any hope. I'll never forget Harold calling our office saying, I'm sitting in the hospital room watching my wife die with our two daughters, but I don't feel alone because I'm watching your video. Oh, there's a world out there. You know what I tell people every day? You don't have to have 300 million views. You don't have to be the senior pastor at Lakewood. There are people in your neighborhood that are hurting right now. Why not give them the hope of Jesus?
That's so powerful. And maybe, Pastor Rick, we'll just go a couple more minutes here, but maybe somebody's watching today and they see you successful. Man, you're a college professor. You got all this, but you know, they don't feel like they can reach their dreams. They've got a lot coming against them. Will you take a couple minutes and just maybe speak some life and hope? I know you're going to speak in a moment, but if you can just maybe encourage somebody that's watching.
Absolutely. You know what, Pastor Joel, I really appreciate this opportunity because oftentimes people will say to me, well, that happened to you, but it couldn't possibly happen to me. Let me tell you this. I've spent more time on the other side of the camera than I have in front of the camera. And when I was on the other side of the camera, God was preparing me. Listen to this. God never puts you on a shelf. There's never a part-time in your relationship with God. You are always being prepared for your destiny. You just have to stay faithful. You might not feel like you're being blessed. You might not see a blessing. You might not realize that you're being blessed. Don't quit. don't stop. In fact, stay tuned to my message, because my message is titled, The Power of Hope. There is hope that is inside of you, just waiting for you to activate it. God declared it over you. So here's my word to you. Regardless of the circumstance, regardless of the situation, regardless of the outcome, regardless of what they said about you, or even what you've said about yourself, guess who's for you? The Lord Jesus, the Christ, the Christo, the Anointed One. And He has infused you with His hope. And I will say to you, get yourself ready. People ask me all the time, Pastor Joel, they say, when will my big break come? My response, that's the wrong question. The right question is, will I be prepared when my break comes? Because we serve a God that specializes in creating opportunities when we least expect them.
I love that. I love it. We're going to turn Pastor Rick loose in just a couple of minutes here and let you have the whole service here and the whole sermon time. But you got to tell me now, Pastor Rick, God's opened these doors where you speak to corporate America.
Yes, sir.
And you know what? You're a voice out there and doing great things. Maybe you can speak to that.
You know what's amazing to me is that I never saw it. I really didn't. In fact, Pastor Michael and Pastor Debbie, my pastors, they saw it before Janet and I saw it. And Billy Graham made an interesting statement toward the end of his life. He said, there's going to be a mighty move and it's going to really be planted in the marketplace. I am out with the biggest companies throughout the world, with schools, with athletic teams, with all kinds of nonprofits. Every single day, Pastor, when I'm finished speaking, now I'm not there as a pastor, I'm there as a motivational speaker. Every single day, someone will come up to me and they'll say, Rick, I want to ask you a question. Is that Jesus real? And can He help me? You know what's interesting? They're not concerned or interested in books, not interested in where I've been, what I've done, and who I know. They want to know, is Jesus real? They want to know the same thing that Nicodemus in the cover of night wanted to know about Jesus. Are you real?
What a great mission field. Oh, I love having you out there. I love your spirit. Okay, we're going to wrap up this, but you got to tell me something funny. Earlier you were saying sometimes people mistake you for Bishop Jakes. And somebody, tell the people that. That's so funny.
I love Bishop. I love Bishop.
So do we.
And I know that he's a friend of Lakewood's. So depending on your age, I'm one of several people. I'm either Carl Winslow from Family Matters. Or I'm Bishop Jakes, and I shared with you that when I go through TSA, if they happen to be African-American, they'll say, I know you're going to sign something, Bishop. I know you're going to sign something. And after they bother you so long, just to get through, you go, God bless you. But, you know, lately I've been CeeLo Green, and every once in a while, I'm John Gray. Oh, God help me.
And tell him about your little grandson, what he said on...
My grandson's watching the Super Bowl. Do you remember the Super Bowl where CeeLo Green was the halftime guest?
Yeah.
I get a call from my grandson. He says, Poppy, why are you singing at the football game? I go, dear Lord, help me. Let me look like Joel. Give me some of that brother's hair.
You look great. All right, y'all, stay with us. We're going to turn Pastor Rick loose in just a moment.
One of the things we believe here at Lakewood is that God wants your family to leave a legacy of faith. He not only wants you to know Him and serve Him, He wants your family, your children, and grandchildren to know Him and serve Him. It's interesting, when you study the Scriptures, you will see a pattern. God often provided salvation for a whole family. In Genesis 7, the earth was facing judgment. A flood was going to destroy all of mankind. God chose Noah and told him to build an ark. And when the time came for the flood, God said to Noah, "Go into the ark, you and your whole family, because I found you righteous in this generation." God made provision for Noah and his family to be saved. When the death angel was going to pass through Egypt, God told the Israelites, each man is to take a lamb for his family, one for each household. That lamb was sacrificed and its blood painted on the doorpost of each home, and the death angel passed over the homes covered in the blood of the lamb. God made provision for the entire family to be spared. In Acts 16, Paul and Silas were in prison when an earthquake supernaturally loosened their chains and opened the prison doors. The jailer fell on his knees, trembling before Paul and Silas, and asked, "What must I do to be saved?" They answered, "Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, and you will be saved, you and your household." The jailer and his family believed and were baptized that same night. But notice again, God made provision for the jailer and his whole family. This should be an encouragement for us to continue to believe God for our loved ones, to continue to believe for a legacy of faith in our family. My father was a great example of this. He gave his life to Jesus at 17 years of age. He was the very first person in his family to become a Christian, and immediately he had a passion to share the love of Jesus with his family members. It took a while, but over the years, his mom and dad and all of his brothers and sisters came to know Jesus. And my dad passed this legacy of faith on to us, to me and all my siblings. And we have, in turn, passed it on to our children and grandchildren. My dad started a legacy of faith in our family. But often the enemy will fight us for our family members. Sometimes they will get off course. Sometimes it looks like they'll never serve God. Sometimes the enemy will try to convince us that there's nothing that we can do, that nothing will ever change. But let me encourage you, we have to fight for this legacy of faith. We have to continue to stand on God's word that says, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Stand on God's word that says the children of the righteous will be mighty in the land. And we have to remember that our prayer for our loved ones can make a difference. The Bible says the prayer of a righteous person is powerful and effective. This should encourage us to pray for our family members who don't know Jesus, to continue to show them the love and kindness of Jesus, to witness to them, and to never give up on them. Because God wants to reach not only us, He wants to reach our entire family as well. This is exactly what happened to our lifelong friends, Billy and Marilyn, and their daughter, Penny, and her son, Brandon. I think their story will encourage you and inspire you to continue to believe God for your loved ones.
I'm Billy Morrison, and this is my wife, Marilyn. And you'll meet my middle daughter, Penny, and her son, Brandon. We began attending the old feed store together in 1966. When I was 25 years old, she was 22. We raised our three daughters here at Lakewood.
We were the very first youth leaders here at Lakewood. We were so excited to help Pastor Osteen and Dodie to do whatever we could to help and serve the vision of Lakewood. We were so honored when he asked us to help with the youth.
My name is Brandon Bedingfield. This is my wife, Candace. I was born in January of 1981. Some of my earliest memories as a child of 3 to 4 years old were coming to Lakewood with my grandparents. I can remember running around the church and sitting on Pastor John and Miss Doty's lap before service. I remember Pastor Joel used to pick me up and let me look through the cameras, and I thought that was so cool. My parents divorced when I was 8 years old, and this had a very big effect on my life. I began to have severe behavioral issues all the way through my teenage years. At that time, I began to think about religion, and I used to think, with so many religions out there, who can be right? They can't all be right. So I decided right then that I was going to believe in nothing. When I was 18, I decided that partying and having fun was the most important thing in life. After many trips to jail for drugs and alcohol and a divorce, my life was a wreck. I lost my two kids, a wife, and I had no money. I was like a prodigal son.
As Brandon's mother, it was so hard to see my son go through so much pain and disappointment in his life. All I could do was love him, pray for him, and be there when he needed me. It seemed the longer I prayed, the worse things got. I learned through my own life that the last thing that would change him was trying to force God on him. I made a decision that no matter what he was doing, I was going to love him. Year after year, I seen him go deeper and deeper into this lifestyle. But I stood firm on the word of God, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. I really had no clue how God would reach him because it was starting to seem impossible. But I knew in my heart, I could never give up on my son.
In 2014, I was a better place financially, and I got remarried to an amazing woman, Candace. In the middle of 2015, my wife and I started attending Lakewood sporadically, just so my kids could see their grandparents and great-grandparents who attended regularly. At least that's what I thought. Little did I know that God was already working on my heart. On February 1st, 2016, a Monday night, my wife asked me, "Do you want to go to that marriage thing at church?" And I had no clue what she was talking about. But I agreed to go. We walked into the chapel for Monday night marriage class. That night, Deidre and her husband, Mark, were guest speakers. I listened to them speak about a good God that loves me no matter what I've done and how he loves and blesses marriage. On that day, I completely surrendered my life to the Lord and rededicated my life to serving him. Almost 5 years later, I'm a leader in the men's ministry and faithfully serve on the men's encounter team, Maximize Manhood, and I help my friend Brian Cody with the men's brigade on various projects. I love helping other men to realize their potential and find the right place as the spiritual leader of their home. I thank God every day for my grandparents and mom who never stopped praying for me. I'm also very thankful to Pastor John and Miss Doty for being obedient to God's plan and starting Lakewood over 60 years ago, giving my grandparents the opportunity to join and start a legacy in my family in 1963. I thank Pastor Joel and Victoria for continuing that legacy. Without Lakewood and the unconditional love of God and a mom and grandparents that knew how to pray, I would not be where I am today.
I love the faithfulness of God. Parents, keep believing for your loved ones, your children, your grandchildren. May seem like they're too far gone, but God has the final say. I believe even right now, he's working in their lives, behind the scenes, drawing them closer to himself. You're going to see the goodness of God in your children. As for you and your house, you will serve the Lord. Now, hey, thanks so much for your tithes and your offerings. You guys are the best givers in all the world. We just speak blessings and favor over you, your finances, your dreams. I'm believing God's going to open up new doors of opportunity for you and that you're going to see overflow. Not just enough for yourself, but you have so much more that you can be a blessing to others. That's God's dream for your life. I was reading in 1 Chronicles, David said, God, everything I have has come from you. How can I give you anything that you haven't already given me? I believe you feel that way. That's the way I feel. God, everything I have, you've given me, the gifts, the talents, the strength, the finances. Now, God, we obey you and we bring our 10% back to you. Many of you give offerings as well. So know that as you give, God says he's going to open windows of heaven, pour out blessings that you cannot contain. That's what we're believing, overflow. Give in faith, expecting God to do great things in your life and in your finances.
So many of our friends along the Gulf Coast were impacted by Hurricane Laura this week. Lakewood became a citywide collection center for supplies and relief efforts. We're loading up trucks and thousands of pounds of water and baby food and diapers. We have teams in place to provide rebuilding and assistance for those affected by the devastation. All of this is possible because of your continued support.
Pastor Joel and Victoria and to the Lakewood Church in Houston. I'm Pastor Gil Arthur, First Baptist Church of Quincy, Louisiana. We are in the midst of a great crisis, but you folks have come through. I can't say enough, but I say thank you. God bless you. We are thankful for the volunteers that are coming, for the goods that have been given. A lot of damage, a lot of work to be done, but God is good, and God is in control, and we love him, we trust him, and we praise God today for all the good things he's doing this very minute.
I love the scripture in Proverbs 16:18. It says, a gift gives way to the giver. When you give gifts, God gives gifts back to you. He makes a way where things look impossible. So I want to thank you so much on behalf of everyone in this ministry and who is helped by this ministry that you are making a way for others. And when you make a way for others, God will always make a way for you. It says that he will usher you into the presence of greatness. So get ready. I believe you're going to see some open doors, some things happen in your life that maybe you didn't even expect. Get ready because God is going to usher you into greatness. When you give, he will always give back to you.
He's going to do some new things in your life. That's why we encourage you every week to give in faith and be expectant as well. Hey, I'd like to thank you for supporting our Hope TV outreach. You guys know that's putting the television program on Sunday nights after the local news in cities across America. It was offered to our ministry. It's an unprecedented opportunity. I think we're in 40 major cities now. We want to keep taking all these cities. That's people watching Sunday nights may not be expecting to watch a television minister, but you know, one touch of God's favor, one seed planted in their hearts can change their lives. We're having so much great response. None of this happens without faithful people like you giving each week. We thank you, and I want to pray God's best over you. Lord, I do lift up all of our givers. Lord, I thank you that you've got them in the palm of your hand. Lord, everything we have has come from you, so we come back to freely give, Lord. Our tithes, our offerings, putting you first place. Lord, I thank you that these gifts are making room for new opportunities, new creativity, new ideas, new relationships. Lord, I thank you for the new things that you're doing. I love, Lord God, that you said even in famine, the righteous will have more than enough, that this pandemic is not going to stop us from having a blessed, prosperous, overflowing year. So Lord, I speak victory, abundance, prosperity, ideas. Let their gifts and talents come out in a new way. Lord, I thank you that blessings and favor, opportunities, resources are chasing them down. Lord, that you're rebuking the devourer for our sake. Lord, we thank you for it. You've done it in the past. We thank you for all you've given us. And Lord, we thank you for an abundant future in Jesus' name. God bless you as you give. We love you very much.
Your generosity is helping us share the message of hope all around the world. Here are some ways you can give. You can text Give Hope to 77977. Go online to lakewoodchurch.com/give. Mail a check to P.O. Box 27450, Houston, Texas, 77227, or call us toll-free at 888-567-JOEL.
Oh,
what a powerful song. God is still on the throne, amen? God's power is unrivaled. Hello, Lakewood family. What a thrill to be with you today. I want to thank Pastors Joel and Victoria for this absolutely awesome opportunity to share the Word of God with you. I want to ask you a question. How many of you could use just a little bit of hope today? How many of you could use just a touch of encouragement today? I want to bring good news. I want to bring the kind of news that fortifies you and reminds you that God is still on the throne. I want to speak a declaration over you right now, a declaration that comes right out of Scripture. My Bible is open to Jeremiah chapter number 29. And in chapter 29, verse 11, listen to this declaration. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you, not plans of despair, plans to give you a future and a hope. Friends, I want to talk to you for just a few minutes today about the power of hope. Not just about hope, but about the power of hope. The power of hope that comes at the revelation of Jesus, the Christ, the Chrismo, the anointed one. I'm so grateful for this plan and this power that comes from the Master. Friends, listen to me for a second. These times are tremendously uncertain. The terrain is uneven. We don't know what the future looks like, but we know who holds the future, amen? Some of you are struggling in ways that you've never struggled before. I get that. Some of you are struggling financially. Some of you are struggling physically. Some of you are not sure exactly what to do. I want to tell you that despite the uncertainty of the hour, we can still have the hope of Jesus Christ. As a matter of fact, I believe that it's uncertainty that literally ignites our hope. Listen to me for just a second. It's in times of certainty that we don't tend to need God as much, or so we think. In times of certainty, we have a redundancy that leads to a predictable kind of response. And if we're not careful, we'll take God for granted, right? But it's in times of uncertainty that our need becomes more exposed. I'm thinking right now about that master prophet, that splendid teacher, Isaiah, when in the presence of Almighty God, he realizes his insatiable need for God. Here's the issue. We, believe me, need God in times of certainty. We just don't see it as clearly. I like times of certainty. I like predictable responses, especially if I'm on an airplane. Come on, somebody. I want my pilot to have a predictable outcome. But it's in times of uncertainty. It's in times when we don't know left from right. It's in times like the ones that we live in right now in the midst of a global pandemic, when our footing is unsure, that we say, God, lead me. Help me. I want to tell you this, friend. Not only will he, not only does he, but he declares over us a strength and a power that only comes from him. I'm talking about the hope found in Jesus, the living Christ. Listen to me. It doesn't matter what the circumstance. It doesn't matter what the situation. It doesn't matter what you're facing. You can depend on hope, as the song sang. You're still an unrivaled God sitting on a throne. And even if we can't depend on anything else, we can depend on the hope that comes at the revelation of Christ. Here's the problem. I think that we've reduced the word hope to the basement of human emotion. And I think the reason why is because of its casual use. There's nothing wrong with that. But listen to how we banter about the word hope. I hope it doesn't rain. I hope I get a parking spot. I hope the Houston Texans win the game, right? And there's nothing wrong with that. But as a result of such a casual use of the word, we've neutered the power out of it. Listen to what the Bible says. David said, my hope is in you, God. David says, I've quieted my spirit. I've silenced my heart that I may focus on you. My soul waits for the hope that is found in you. May the God of hope, Paul said, fill you with all peace and all joy. May you abound in the hope of him. What did you say, Job? Yet though he slay me, I will hope in him. I will trust in him. So here's the first thing I want you to think about, friends. Listen to me. This hope that comes from Christ, this isn't wish fulfillment. This isn't a fleeting moment. This isn't a passing impulse. This is hope that comes from God that's active, that's transformative, that's dynamic, that's life-changing. Do these words sound like a fleeting, passing moment? My hope is in you, God. My soul meditates on your hope, God, that you can fill me with the kind of hope, Lord, that will cause me to abound in joy and to abound in peace. Does this sound like wish fulfillment? Even though you slay me, I will hope in you. I want to tell you something, friends. Hope is the character of God. Hope is personified by the Son of God. Hope is the nature of God. Hope is the heart of God. Hope is the power of God. And hope lives in every single one of us. As a matter of fact, I've defined hope as a quality from God within every human spirit that places a transformative demand upon us to believe for the absolute best outcome. My hope is in Christ. My hope isn't in the news. Come on. My hope isn't in all these other sources. My hope isn't in what I thought I heard somebody say. My hope is in Jesus the Christ. I learned that from a third grade dropout. Wisest man I ever met in my life, a third grade dropout, my daddy, who said, son, don't ever lose hope. As a matter of fact, he grew up in Texas, and I used to make fun of him when I didn't understand, because I thought he didn't know how to pronounce help, the word help. My father would say, Ricky, this is my friend John. John hoped me. That's what he would say growing up, and it was embarrassing to me. I didn't realize until years later, my daddy was absolutely right. What he was saying is, John infused my life with a godly hope. My father and mother, they modeled hope. They always had an expectation that things would get better no matter how rocky, no matter how uneven the terrain, no matter how uncertain the moment. I'm sure that they had times that they kept away from us kids when they didn't know whether to pay the light bill or the water bill. I've been there. When they didn't know what to do, which way was up, but they knew who was up, and they knew who to put their trust in. No wonder Helen Keller said, hope sees the invisible, feels the intangible, achieves the impossible. I'm talking about a godly hope. I'm talking about a hope that you can't rent, a hope that you can't barter, a hope that you can't buy, a hope that you can't purchase. I'm talking about a hope that's been infused in our DNA. The critical question is, will you acknowledge it? That's right. Hope requires faith. It requires faith. I love what the great communicator Les Brown said on one occasion. He said, faith is the oil that takes the friction out of life. Isn't that good? Hope doesn't just require faith. Hope requires courage. It was Winston Churchill who said on one occasion that fear is a reaction, but courage is a choice. And hope require, this is my favorite. Hope requires an immediate, decisive response. If you're listening to me right now at home and you don't have any hope, you don't have any reason for which to hope, change your thinking, it'll change your words. Change your words, it'll change your behaviors. Change your behaviors and attitudes, it will affect your character. It will begin to shape your destiny. Begin speaking words of hope over you. I just said that hope requires an immediate, decisive response. Let me give you an example. Then Job arose, tore his robe, shaved his head, fell to the ground and worshiped, and said, naked I came from my mother's womb. Naked I shall return. The Lord giveth and the Lord taketh away. But I have decided to say, blessed be the name of the Lord. God gives us hope and says, act on it. Hope is active. Act on it. Hope is dynamic. Act on it. Hope is transformative. Act on it. Hope is life-changing, friend. Oh, if you will believe the word of God. Just like the song said, he is sitting on a throne. He is unrivaled. And he's saying to every one of us today, you have my hope at your disposal. I thank God for that. A few years ago, I wrote a book titled Afraid to Hope. And it's been received well. But I would get some criticism from time to time. I would get some criticism from business leaders. They would say, Rick, we like your book, but we just want to tell you, hope is not a strategy. It's not a strategy. We enjoy your book, but hope's not a strategy. And it stung. I took it personally. Do y'all know that it took a global pandemic? Come on. It took racial strife all over the world for me to realize they're absolutely correct. Hope is not a strategy. Hope is more powerful than a strategy. A strategy is a plan. Hope is a belief. A strategy can change with the wind. Hope is a belief, a declaration that has been spoken over us, a virtue that is inside of our hearts. Friend, listen to me. The hope of Christ makes all the difference in the world. I don't want to go to a church if the pastor doesn't have any hope. I don't want to be in a family if there's no hope. God knows I don't want to be on an airplane if the pilot has no hope. Come on, somebody. Do y'all hear what I'm saying to you? You cannot lead without hope. You cannot live without hope. I remember there was a time in my life that I lost hope. I was afraid to hope. And what I didn't realize was that hope was residing right inside of me. I want to talk to the folks right now that have no hope. I want to talk to the folks right now that need a dose of hope. You have no reason for which to hope. I know what you're thinking because I've been on the other side of the camera. This is what you're thinking. Oh, Rick, you're at Lakewood. Rick, you're in front of the camera. Things are going well for you. It hasn't always been the case. Most of my life, I haven't been in front of the camera on a stage. Most of my life, I've been saying, God, can you help me? God, can you help me figure out a way? Most of my life, I've been saying, God, show me a way. Help me see a way out. Father, help me to reconnect with your hope. I grew up in a God-fearing home. I grew up with parents that loved the Lord. I grew up with all kinds of advantages from a spiritual perspective. Probably the greatest advantage were having folks that had poor spirits. I'm not talking financially impoverished. I'm talking about demonstrating their need for God to God every single day. And in doing so, ego left, pride left. And so they constantly talked about the hope found at the revelation of Jesus Christ. That's part of my DNA. But how many of you know that despite what you learn, you can go through some seasons in your life where you lose hope? I want to talk to folks that are there right now. I need to tell you all a story that will help illustrate what I'm talking about. Back in the 1970s, I met the finest woman I've ever met in my life. Mm-hmm. Back in my day, we would have called her a brick house. Do y'all know what I'm talking about? I'm talking about just a beautiful woman. There was just one little problem. Back in the 70s, ladies weren't crazy about big old clumsy linemen. The Blind Side movie hadn't come out yet. And so the ladies were interested in the quarterbacks, the running backs, the golfers, the runners like Pastor Joel, those lean, mean fighting machines, not Big Daddy, but that's all right. We go to this dance, and there she was, most beautiful woman I'd ever seen. I can remember it as if it was yesterday. I had on a purple leisure suit. Come on, somebody. I had on purple platform shoes. I look like a Black Barney. Y'all don't hear what I'm saying to you. Anyway, I said to my friend, I have to meet her. And so I just looked at her and I thought, she's way out of my league. So I go to the snack table. And I'm over at the snack table, and all of a sudden I hear my mother's voice Let me just pause and tell you, the words you hear are powerful. Listen to me. The words that you speak over yourself are powerful. The words that you share with your children are powerful. I got a third grade dropout daddy. He's quoting Michelangelo over me and my brother every single day. Ricky? Yes, daddy. Ricky, I'm not gonna have a problem if you aim high and miss, but I'm gonna have a real issue if you aim low and hit. Ricky? Yes, daddy. How you do anything is how you do everything. Ricky? Yes, daddy. It's never wrong to do the right thing. Make sure, son, your servant's towel is bigger than your ego. Kind deeds are never lost. Don't judge people. Make sure you're showing up early. He said to me, as Pastor Joel and I talked a little earlier, he said, son, you'd rather be an hour early than a minute late. You know what he was saying? The same thing I tell business leaders all over the world. If you're called a leader, it is your privilege to inconvenience yourself daily for the sake of those who follow you. So I grew up hearing powerful, positive affirmations declared over us. I grew up listening to a mother quote Henry Ford, baby, yes, mother, if you think you can or if you think you can't, you're right. So I'm at the dance, purple leisure suit, looking fly, an afro so big I couldn't get in a Volkswagen. Still can't get in a Volkswagen, but that's all right. And so now I'm seeing this woman and I'm thinking she's out of my league. But I hear my mother's declaration over me. If you think you can, or if you think you can't, you're right. I went for it. Walked out on the dance floor. Introduced myself. My name is Ricky Rigsby. She said, hi, my name is Trina Williams. I said, may I dance with you? She said, sure. We started dancing. I think we were doing the bump. It was the 1970s. I had to be careful because a week earlier I'd bumped a woman out of an apartment complex, so I've just got to calm it down a little bit. We have such a good time during the dance, I get carried away, pull out a pencil and a piece of paper, and ask Trina for her telephone number. Y'all, Trina was the first, actually, she was the only woman in college who gave me her actual real telephone number. That was a Saturday night. The next day, Sunday, after church, I'm trying to call her. I'm trying to get up the nerve to call her. My friend is sitting on the bunk bed in our dorm room for moral support. What came out of my mouth made my friend laugh so hard he fell off the bed. On a landline phone with a rotary dial, I call Trina and I say, will you go to Baskin and Robbins ice cream parlor and have an ice cream cone? To my shock, she said yes. So we walked the 6 miles there because my car wasn't working very well, and I made her laugh. I was always taught to be a gentleman, and I was always taught by that third grade dropout that being a gentleman is one of the last vestiges of chivalry. And so I made sure that I was a gentleman. And we walked back to the dorm, and I made her laugh. And we went on a second date, and a third date, and a fourth date. Come on, somebody. And do you know a fine woman will cause you to walk the right way? Y'all don't hear what I'm saying. A fifth date, a sixth date. We started going together. That's what we called it back in the 70s. We are now going together into the holiday season. So I take my girlfriend home to visit my mother and my father. My daddy, I'll never forget, he's standing at the screen door as we're getting our luggage out of the car, and he looked at Trina, and then he looked at me. He whispered in my ear, is she okay? Is she psycho? Are there any mental issues? Is everything good? We continued dating. We dated all through college, and finally, my senior year, I got down on one knee and I proposed. Now, this was the 70s. All of Trina's girlfriends said, now you need to get down on one knee and you need to have some chocolate-covered strawberries and you need to make sure you have a blanket and you need to do it when the sun is setting. I just got down on one knee. That's all Big Daddy could do, was just get down on one knee. But here's the deal. She said, yes. The finest woman I had ever met in my life said yes. Y'all ever go to a wedding? I bet you have here at Lakewood. I'm sure you have here at Lakewood. You ever go to a wedding and before the wedding even starts, you hear people in the congregation saying, "How in the world?" And it was coming from my side of the family, but that didn't deter me one bit. We get married, we start our respective careers. Trina is a labor and delivery nurse. I'm a local television reporter in Chico, California. We eventually have a couple of children, two little sons. Our life is just a fairy tale. Other than $8 million in student loans, we're living the magical life. We recommit our lives to the Lord our first year of marriage, and we are on fire for Jesus. Everything is going great until we hit a time of uncertainty. Everything is going well until all of a sudden we come upon some uneven terrain. Everything is going lovely. As a matter of fact, during those years of certainty, I would pull God out of the back seat whenever I needed him. Come on, Rick, preach. I would pull God out of the trunk whenever I needed to visit with him. But God, you stay at a distance because I really don't need you now. Or so I thought. In fact, a few years after we were married, I was called to preach in the 80s. And here I am preaching, but I don't know the word of God. And God would try to get my attention. And guess what I would do with his words? I would reduce his words to bite-sized portions. I would minimize his, I would ignore his words. But then uneven terrain hit. Certainty gave way to uncertainty. And just like Isaiah, I'm ruined. I'm undone. God, I need you. Help me. If you're there today, I've got good news. It may not sound like good news, but just stay tuned. Trina found a lump in her left breast. Breast cancer. 6 years after that diagnosis, in a little town 90 minutes from here called College Station, Texas, me and my two little boys walked up to mommy's casket. If it wasn't for the Lord, I don't know if I would have made it. If it wasn't for those two little boys, I don't know where I'd be. But guess whose wisdom sustained me during the worst days of my life? The biblical declarations of a third grade dropout. Remember the scripture that I read for you to start this sermon? The declaration of a future and a hope? Imagine that declaration coming forth as you're staring into the casket of your wife, staring into the casket of the mother of your boys. I remember at that funeral home in College Station, Texas, saying, "Daddy, I've lost hope." My father, a third grade dropout, said, "Son, you can't lose something God gave you. You haven't lost hope. You've lost perspective." Friends, there are some of you out there right now, and I know that feeling, and I sympathize with you, but let me lift you up. You haven't lost. If you're watching right now, you haven't lost. If you're breathing right now, you haven't lost. If you're putting one foot in front of the other, you haven't lost hope. You can't lose what God gave you. What you've lost is perspective. My father wasn't done. At the casket, he said three words that literally changed the direction of my life. He said, "Son, just stand." I'm placing a demand upon you right now to stand. You know why? Because I've been at rock bottom. Remember I told you that hope requires faith. Hope requires courage. Hope requires an immediate, decisive response. My father was placing a demand upon my heart to not quit, to not give up, by simply reminding me what our God has always promised, that I got for you a future, boy. I got for you a hope boy. Friends, listen to me. It doesn't matter what it looks like. I wish I could preach. God's got a future and a hope for you. Pastor Rick, I don't see it. Doesn't matter. Pastor Rick, I can't feel it. Doesn't matter. Pastor Rick, my kids are wayward. Doesn't matter. Pastor Rick, he's left and he's not coming back. Doesn't matter. Pastor Rick, I've run out of money. Doesn't matter. Pastor Rick, I'm on unemployment and it's about to run out. Doesn't matter. Pastor Rick, I'm terrified. Pastor Rick, I've lost friends and loved ones as a result of this pandemic. Listen to the word of God. He's declaring over your life this very moment a future and a hope. Take it from a man who stood at the edge of his wife's grave, clutching the hands of two little boys. And I want to declare over you what my daddy declared over me. Son, just keep standing. Friend, I want to tell you, you're not standing on your own power, because the circumstances and the situations of life have caused you to see your desperate need for Jesus. So this is what I want you to do. I want you to call on that name. Call on that name that is above every name. Why do I want to do that, Pastor Rick? Because this is what I learned at rock bottom. It wasn't just a song that my folks used to sing, but there truly is something about that name. Friend, there's power in that name. There's healing in that name. There is life in that name. There is encouragement in that name. There is hope in that name. Jesus. Just practice saying it right now, Jesus. You can't see any way out, but just practice, Jesus. You can't even get off the ground, Jesus. You might be listening and watching from a hotel, from a hospital room. Just say it, Jesus. You might be listening from a jail cell. Just Jesus, 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 Mary's baby boy, Jesus. Jesus, Matthew's King, Jesus, Jesus, Mark's suffering servant, Jesus, Jesus, Luke's great physician, Jesus, 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 John's word becoming flesh. There's power in that name. Let me show you what that name will do, friends. When I decided to respond to the declaration of a mother, when I decided to respond to the declaration of a father that were echoing the words of the prophet Jeremiah, that I have for you a future and a hope, something rose. My will stood at attention. And I realized one thing. I could either roll over and play dead, or I could have an immediate, decisive response to my Father and my Heavenly Father. I chose the latter. Y'all ain't gonna believe this. You're not gonna believe what I'm about to tell you. I'm gonna talk to you about hope right now. A while later, after the most horrific days of my life, I started speaking again. I started preaching again. At 6 o'clock one morning in College Station, Texas, I'm doing a Bible study when I spot the finest woman I have ever met in my life again. Lost my place in my notes. Got a bit disheveled and unraveled, but I somehow continued on. Let me save several paragraphs and get to the point. The first thing that my wife, Janet, did was she adopted those little boys, fulfilling Trina's dying wish that her babies not go through life without a mama. And then we decided to have more children. Turned out to be boys, more boys. Today, My boys go from 37 all the way down to 20. But this is what I've come to Lakewood to share with my new family. If you're listening, say amen. If you're listening, throw something at the television screen right now. This is what it comes to. Don't miss this. What if I were to tell you that I saw hope personified by a dying wife who, barring a miracle from God, knew the time of her departure had come? Watch this. She didn't just read God declaring her a future and a hope. She lived it to her last breath. 2 days before Trina died, no hair because of chemotherapy, a tummy pooched out because of a liver no longer working. She weighed about 80 pounds. I'll never forget this day. She's sitting on a couch in our living room, surrounded by pillows to ease the pain. I notice out of the corner of my eye, I'm in the kitchen keeping an eye out on Trina. I notice out of the corner of my eye, our youngest son at the time, Andrew, walking down the stairs with a shirt. And this is what I heard Mommy say to her son. Andrew, Mama, not always gonna be here to help you. She was saying goodbye to her baby. I waited for Andrew to leave, and I walked over to Trina, and I sat next to her on the couch. And without her breathing labored whatsoever, friends, as clearly as I'm speaking to you right now, these were some of my wife's last words to me. Ricky, it doesn't matter to me any longer how long I live. What matters to me most is how I live. You're gonna tell me, Rick, that she made that kind of declaration of faith, that she made that kind of declaration of hope in her last 48 hours? Yes. Why? Because she believed the word of God. She believed that he is still on the throne no matter what. She believed that his power is without rival. And she declared something to me that said this: no matter what, I will hope in you. No matter what, I will trust in you. Doesn't matter any longer how long I live. What matters is how I live. Lakewood, I want to ask you a question. How you living? How you living? Let's decide right now that we're going to start living with a healthy dose of heavenly hope. As a matter of fact, why don't you be a change agent by being an agent of hope? Nothing, absolutely nothing, allows you to get out of a rut like hope that motivates you to help somebody else. How you living? How you living? Here's how I pray you're living. I pray that the hope found at the revelation of Christ is causing you to abound in his peace and in his joy, always and forever, regardless of the circumstance. Friend, you might be watching this broadcast right now, and you might be saying, I've come to the end of the line. I'm at rock bottom. I see nothing but need. I see nothing but loss. I see nothing but pain and hurt. Rick, what do I need to do to see Jesus? Simply repeat this prayer after me. Jesus, I believe that you're the Savior of the world. I believe that you were born of a virgin, that you walked this earth for 33 years, that you died on a cross, that you were resurrected, and now you intercede for us at the right hand of the Father. Come into my life. Make me new. Change my life. Give me that hope that Pastor Rick has talked about. Let me activate that hope so that it's dynamic, transformative, active in my life. And I promise to make you my Savior and my Lord. If you prayed that prayer, get into a great Bible-believing church so that you can grow and grow and grow so that hope may abound in your life, in your lives, in the generations that you produce forever and ever and ever. How you live in Lakewood. Pastor Joel.
So beautiful, Pastor Rick Rigsby. Thank you, Pastor. Beautiful. The power of hope. We love you. Come back often.
Thank you.
But we're moved, and we know that our hope is in the Lord.
Amen.
We love you, Lakewood. We pray for you. You're not going to have an average week. You're going to have a blessed week. Know that God's in control, and we're going to keep our hope in the Lord. Not just come out, but we're going to come out even better. Until we meet again, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord show you His favor and have mercy on you. May the Lord watch over you and give you His peace. God bless you. We love you very much. See you back real soon.